Thanks for joining us this morning. On the papers this morning, there have been some stories about insecurity. I'll start with what we have on the Vanguard newspaper here, saying banditry, secure your forest, federal government charges states. Now, federal government is asking state governments to secure their forest. When you hear that kind of information on the news coming from the federal government, how do you perceive that the states should react to this?
Well, as a result of the situation in the country today, but let's not forget that security matter first is the prerogative of the federal government. It is the center that is supposed to actually direct the national security. That's why all of them at the National Security Council, they report to Mr. President. Do not forget also that all the chiefs, talking about the chief of air staff, the chief of army staff, the chief of naval staff, and the chief of defense, including the minister of defense, they all also report to Mr. President. And so all other paramilitary agencies, we are talking about the other security agencies now, who also report to Mr. President via the national security advisor, also direct their issues and matters to Mr. President. And so state governors are meant to be the chief security officers of their states. But even so, where there's conflict, the constitution takes precedence. That is to say that the federal security at the federal level is number one. But be that as it may, I'd like you to also understand that currently, banditry is ravaging the northwest and some other parts of the country, just like you have Boko Haram sitting on the northeast and some other parts of the country, particularly the north. Now, the army, that when I use the army, I'm talking about the military holistically. They have been overstressed. These same persons are the persons who are, these personnel are those who are drafted to fight Boko Haram. These same personnel are those who are drafted to fight bandits. These same personnel are those who are drafted to fight the herders and kidnappers. And so, recently we have had some revelations coming from bandits and some persons. I take your mind back to what happened in Niger State, when 27 persons, 27 children and their staffers, their teachers were taken by a group of the bandits. Now, that man, the kidnapper released the video that passed through Gumi and was received by the press. That audio was in Hausa. And when interpreted, that man made a very vital statement, and I want you to listen to it. What he said, part of it, an extract of what he said was that the man who gave him the business was in the town with all of you who are planning on how to get him arrested in the forest. That as you're making your plans, that the planned information is getting to him, and so it will be difficult for you to get at him. What does that tell you? The underlying factor of that is that man was in the forest in Mango State, and he said somebody gave him the business. I draw you back to Zamfara State, where the governor, after the release of 270-something children, I was actually in Zamfara State that morning when the children were released. I was in Sokoto when they were speaking.
Okay.
Now, the governor made a statement. He said if he told us the persons behind banditry, that Nigerians would be shocked. And immediately, don't forget that the federal government reacted to that statement. After the release of those children, remember that the NSC did make some statements on behalf of Mr. President and the federal government. And quickly thereafter, the federal government took a decision. And one of it was that Zamfara State was declared a no-fly zone. One, two, gold mining was suspended in Zamfara State, whether the illegal gold mining or the legal one, all of it was suspended. And then the governor again contact that, telling Mr. President that he has been doing all he has to do within his capacity to ensuring that peace returned to Zamfara and that the bandits were conquered. Don't also forget that the Zamfara state governor has been doing work within his own measure, like amnesty program for the bandits. Again, you would recall that banditry actually started from Zamfara state through the illegal miners who were arming some boys as police or soldiers to fight and protect them. Okay? And the Zamfara state governor, again, when the NSA made that statement, and the president declared that in an he also countered. A few days after, he told us that a soldier and his girlfriend allegedly have been arrested, who were supposedly supplying weapons and uniforms, military uniforms to the bandits. And so perhaps, don't also forget what the governor of Kaduna State said at the time, talking about El-Rufai. When he made a statement to say that he was not going to join the other northern governors who were trying to put hands together to find a lasting solution to the issue of banditry.
I'm going to butt in here. Now that we are mentioning these governors and some of the things that have been going on, let's do an assessment as security consultants. Do you think that the state's governors can get the equipment, the paramilitary or state policing to be able to tackle banditry as states, as individuals now? Let's look at this as an assessment. Do you think that it can be executed if each state governor is asked to have their own arms, ammunition, and everything they need, the police, the security agencies, to tackle the specific issues going on in their states? Do you think this is going to change anything?
Nobody is going to do that. You cannot get state governors to procure ammunition or to own their own ammunition to begin to do what they want to do. There is a limit to which they can do as provided by the Constitution. I don't know how much of that you know about. And if you ask state governors to begin to have of their weapons, that means you are saying that they should have their dumps and they should also have their armories, which is not possible. It is unconstitutional. That, again, could be misused during elections. Now, what the state governors, that was exactly the point I was coming to before you cut me short. As I speak with you now, the Kaduna state governor had hosted the other 18 state governors of the North, where they talked about how to conquer banditry and terrorism up north. There's a limit to which they can go. The state governors do not have power, do not have command over the military. I hope you know that. And so who is going to fight the bandits or the terrorists? Are you saying the state governors are going to set up their own military and arm them? Is it possible? Obviously, the answer is no. That is not possible. There's a limit to which they can go. Apparently provide the logistics, apparently support intelligence gathering, you know, and apparently support the military and those who are fighting the bandits by giving quality information concerning how to reach these persons and who they are. Security is the business of everybody. Say what you know, say what you have seen, say what you have heard. As much as that will not mislead intelligence, as much as that will help intelligence, as much as that will help arrest. Apparently, that is why we have the undercover agents. That is also why we have the informants. Where there are official informants, there are unofficial informants. There are also the official undercover agents. All of these are roles each of these persons are supposed to play. If the governor of Zamfara says, he made a statement that allegedly seemed to be that he knows some of these persons. If the man in the forest who kidnapped the 27 children in Niger State from what's the name of the school again now, did say that somebody gave that thing, the kidnapping of those children, to him as a business, it meant that some persons within certain places are behind all of this, and some persons also know them. So by the time the state governors are involved, by giving out this quality information, cooperating with the security agents, cooperating with the federal government, and all of that, at the end of the day, definitely will be getting us somewhere. I do not want anybody to misinterpret the house, what the position of the federal government or Mr. President. he never would want to say that the state governor should, the state government should bear arms. The Constitution does not provide for that.
Let's move to a major story on the Punch newspaper this morning from the president. Buhari admits border closure didn't stop illegal arms inflow. How did you perceive that statement? The president coming out to say, yes, we tried to close the borders, but it didn't stop the movements of illegal arms inflow into the country. Do you think that that would go well with those that are listening, especially coming from the president?
I'm not sure I heard it clearly.
Okay, on the Punch newspaper this morning, can you hear me clearly now?
Can you take it calmly?
All right, I'll take the question again. On the Punch newspaper this morning, we have it that President Buhari admits that border closure did not stop illegal arms inflow.
Okay.
Yes.
I'll tell you something. It's not the first time it happened to me. Don't forget that at a point in time, Mr. President did say that I think it will take God to police our borders or something. I can't remember exactly the way he said it. But I'll tell you this, there's nowhere in the world where any country can completely police its border. I also tell you this for free, that about 2 weeks ago, I was in the Northwest, five states of the Northwest, in company of the Presidential Committee on Small Arms and Light Weapons, where we had to train security agents. And some of the areas I trained them on was methods and techniques of arms smuggling. Now, Nigeria is bordered by four countries. Now, all of these four countries, you have the legal routes and you also have the illegal routes. Now, the manpower of our customs. The manpower of immigration, the manpower of the NDLE, I'm not talking about only those who are meant to checkmate that, bring in all of these security agents, and then bring in the military, all of them, line them up from the beginning of one border point to the end, they cannot cover it. Okay? Now, okay. Even with the bigger rules, mm-hmm. there are methods the arms smugglers use. Now, definitely, the security agents, these are some of the things I have to do before them so that they will also understand it and then help you. My sister, do you know, as I speak with you now, you do not have the unmanned area vehicles patrolling our borders. We do not have that. We do not have some of our gadgets, even some of the scanners in some of these border posts, where you have former border points, are not even working. At some other border points, there's really nothing there. It's just a stroll in and a stroll out. And then because of the ECOWAS treaty also, there are grazing areas in between two countries where animals are also used to bring in these weapons. We call them small arms. Okay, you have cattle grazing across borders, you have camels grazing across borders, you have sheep, you have donkeys, you have all of that grazing. This is one method through which this comes in. How do you checkmate all of that? What security gadgets have been put in place to gather intelligence concerning all of that? Do you also know that this foreign rights they bring in, they also use it to bring in dismembered arms, small arms, whether in whole or not? You also know that trucks are also used. They create false compartments in these trucks to bring in ammunition. Since the fall of Libya, we know that most of the small arms that are cut away from that region, they come into the northern part of this country. And how do they come in? The border posts at the northern end of this country, there are areas where there are even just too porous. Some areas don't even have structure. Apparently, this is what the Presidential Committee on Small Arms and Light Weapons, on behalf of the federal government and the European Union, the EU, are doing at the moment to see how they could checkmate all of this. But I tell you this, even so, it is not possible anywhere in the world for any country to police its border. border completely. Not even America. Not even the United States of America, as rich as they are in intelligence gathering and all of that. But even so, here, I think we do not even have one third of what we need to checkmate the activities of smugglers, particularly the cartel, who use mold to bring in some of these firearms. How much do you... You see, proliferation of small arms and light weapons in the country today is overwhelming. It's overwhelming. Aside from the state actors who are supposedly meant to handle firearms, you find firearms everywhere. And then the EU, ECOWAS, and the federal government of Nigeria are also working on mopping up of firearms. A project is currently going on right now in Uyo and Calabar, where they are giving alternative livelihoods to all of those who drop their firearms. Okay? Now, Mr. President is saying what he knows based on the quality information as submitted to him either by the NSA or the chiefs. But I think this is for every year, let me say this please, for every year money is budgeted. You remember that recently the NSA made a statement that is accusing the recently chiefs who resigned their appointment and have been given ambassadorial positions, that the billions of dollars that were meant for the purchase of arms, they can, the new chiefs say they cannot find those arms. Did you remember that?
Yes, I can.
And so the budget to fight insurgency, to fight banditry, to fight kidnappers, to fight the headers, where are they? Where are they? And now what will this government, what will Mr. President do to the teaser that the NSA just posed when he stated that the new chiefs said they cannot find the small arms and light weapons that ordinarily ought to have been bought by the outgone chiefs? Well, he also tried to defend that by saying that he is not saying that they have where corruption has taken place, that maybe they are on their way to the country. But all of that are playing out. We are trying to look at what comes out of all of that. But if you want to take, if you want to look at history, antecedent of what we have seen, how four chiefs before this last wars were involved in corruption.
Okay. Unless
you want to very study what this NSA has said.
All right. I'd like to butt in here. Multinational tax force are around to move around at these borders and checkmate the activities going on here. With what is going on, is it a sign that their efforts are not making so much progress?
Your line is rumbling. I'm not hearing you very clearly.
Can you hear me clearly? Multinational tax force are on our borders, are moving around our borders to also checkmate some of these activities that we've seen in the papers this morning. Is this a sign that they need to do more than what is already in place at the moment? Is this a sign that they need to do more than what they are already doing at the moment?
Look, intelligence has gone beyond physical presence. The job of a thousand persons can be done by just two persons. I'll give you an example. It's not about lying. I told you earlier on that even if you lined up all the security agencies you have, from the beginning of Cameroon to the end of Niger or Chad, because you have these four countries that we share border with. Okay, Niger, Republic of Benin, Chad, and Cameroon. Now, if you line up all these personnel, they cannot do anything. Well, they can only do a little. That you have the multinational force, you know, patrolling the border. Are they patrolling also the illegal routes? There are terrains that even it will take the extra mile for you to gather. What you actually need are the unmanned area vehicles. You also have the manned area vehicles you need. You remember the issue of when America took on two persons in Iraq, one from Iran and one Iraqi, that created a commotion before the advent of coronavirus, where Iran was saying that they were going to hit America back. Those two persons were not making by physical presence of anybody. You remember that? An unmanned area vehicle was meant to do the job. That unmanned area vehicle followed those persons to the point where they took them out, if you remember all of that. And the man who was in the control room and directing that unmanned area vehicle was never seen. And so you also have this unmanned area vehicle you can use to monitor or police our borders. Our borders are very, very porous. Even the ones that are manned. Do you understand? So it's not about physical monitoring. We are talking about gadgets that can see beyond what the eyes could see. We are talking about gadgets that will give signals. We are talking about gadgets that will bring up or create images that are discovered in some of those methods and techniques used by the cartels. Do you know that you could look at certain consignments with the physical eye, and that can even beat the scanner? Do you also know that even with the scanner, if they follow legal routes, they can even also beat the scanner with a gadget they plant on? For instance, if you have a container, a container that is coming legally with spare parts, they could build four compartments on that same container, either at the bottom or on the side. And then when they build it could also be scanner if a gadget is planted on that container. Ordinarily, when you dismember gadgets, for instance, you take the trigger, or the butt, or the chamber, or the muzzle of a barrel, for instance. If you dismember them, let me give you an example. In Mexico, a crime was committed with an AK-47. And then when that AK-47 was recovered, they tried to do what we call tracing. Tracing would allow you to find out where the gadget was manufactured, and then who bought the gadget from the manufacturer, and then what date it was bought, and then find out whether the person who bought that gadget had lost it or lose it to criminals, and whether it was reported. That is another, it's a full topic. Let me just give you that summary. Now, when that gadget was discovered and was traced back to America, do you know what was discovered? It was discovered that gadget was actually assembled by a cartel in America in bits, and those bits passed through the post office in America. He imported those things, either the trigger in quantities that you would not even say this is for a small for a firearm. And then the buyers came in small quantities and they were delivered. The one you call online trading. That was where that thing was. So you find out that the methods and techniques used by this person, every day they even pay scientists to help them discover how to beat the security agents in bringing in these small arms. They could bring them in beat and couple them here. They could bring them in as a whole. Do you know, let me also shock you this morning. Do you know that spare tires are also used to ferry in small arms and light weapons? Spare tires. You see spare tires of trucks in a truck, inflated, but you do not know that inside of those spare tires, you have bits or holes of shotgun or parts of a firearm. So it's an ongoing thing. What Mr. President has done is what he's supposed to do. Now, tasking the state governors to assist in the area of monitoring security in their state is very much in place. But please let us not misunderstand it. They also have limitations as provided by the Constitution. So if you have multinational forces at your focal point, if they are just there physically,
thank you so much for your thoughts this morning, Umoro Darlington. Thank you so much for your thoughts this morning. And we hope that our security stories in Nigeria changes as the time goes on.
That's why Mr. President is doing all within his capacity.
Okay.
To ensure that all of these are contained. And then for the top, he will to arrest prostitutes for this person. My dear, I do not think we will just be trying to cut the tree from the head and not from the base. We need to get at the sponsors, and we need to get them arrested, and they need to be prosecuted. You know, armed smuggling is big business. Armed smuggling is big business. And those who are into that business, who are passing all this small arms and life, but of course you have the legal ones, those who have license, and then also you have the illegal ones. Those illegal ones are those who are passing on those small arms to the non-state actors who are using them to commit crime. Well, let's leave it at this morning.
Thank you very much for giving us your thoughts this morning, Darlington Omoro.
Thank you very much.
We hope that the stories change in the news. Do have a great day ahead.
Thank you very much. And you too.
Yeah, bye-bye. That's as much as we can take on the newspaper review this morning. But like I said, you can catch up with the details of the stories on our 3 p.m. bulletin and our 9 p.m. bulletin. But till I see you again, stay safe. My name is Esther Kalu. Take care of yourself.